Welcome to Concepts of Programming Languages. In this video, I want to talk about functional programming, fixed points, and referential transparency. So let's get started. So in this talk, I will restrict myself at least to functions from natural numbers to natural numbers. So whenever I talk about functions, I mean functions between natural numbers. So there's this programming language style or paradigm that is called functional programming. But then you might ask yourself, what is a functional? So a functional you can think of as a function of a function. So as you may know, functions have arguments. Now what if an argument to a function is itself a function? Then the outer function you could call a functional. So here is an example. Before the example, functionals are also called higher order functions. It's just a synonym. But here's an example of a higher order function. So suppose you have the function f, and you define f that takes two arguments, a g and an x, and the value of f with arguments g and x is equal to the function g applied to x. So as you can see, now the argument g itself is a function because it takes an argument, in this case x that is also supplied to f. So other examples of higher order functions will come later. Now in functional programming, the main idea is to program with these higher order functions. So it is also called people also say that in functional programming, functions themselves are first class citizens. So that means that you can directly work with functions in the programming language. And you don't have to do a lot of convoluted stuff to maybe encode functions. Now you can directly express what you want to do with functions. Talking about first class citizens, by the way, maybe I should apologize for being ill last week, but I took an injection to become a first class citizen myself. So what can we do with functions? Well, the most typical operations on functions are applying functions. So that means that you have, say, a value, and then you apply that value to the function. So that allows you to supply that as an input to the function. Now there is also this concept of partial application. I will come back to that later. And what you can also do with functions is function composition. So given two functions, you could compose the two functions to obtain a new function. Also, that I will explain later in this video. Now, there are very interesting concepts what you could do with functions, and one of them is function iteration. It's iterated function composition. And an important concept when talking about functions are their fixed points. Finally, in this video, I will talk a little bit about the lambda calculus again and its famous Y combinator. Now, what are examples of functional programming languages? And you could look these functional programming languages up either in the book of the course, or you could look for it on the web. You could say that these are not all functional programming languages out there, but the most well-known. You have Lisp, of which the scheme and closure implementations are widely used. You have ML, that stands for meta language, of which there are two well-known implementations, standard ML and OCaml. And there is the functional programming language Haskell. Okay, so in this video, I will remain mostly in the abstract. If you want to know more about functional programming, you could maybe look up for a tutorial on the web that explains how, in practice, you could program using functions. Okay, so let's consider function application. Suppose you're given a function, say f, then you could say, well, how many arguments does f expect as an input? And this number, the number of arguments of f, is called its arity. So here are some example functions. So let's say that this is the successor function and it takes one argument, so its arity is one. Here you have the plus function, it takes two arguments, x and y, so its arity is two. Here you have a higher order function, it's called app for application, which takes an argument f, which itself is a function, and an argument x. And the meaning of app, by the way, is what you have seen on the previous slide, because the meaning of app applies x to f. So the value of app fx is x applied to f. Another example of a function would be swap. Swap takes three arguments, so its arity is three. And the meaning of swap is that whenever you take swap, supply it with the function f, and then the second and third arguments are then swapped and applied to f. But I'll come back to that later. Then there is another higher order function, comp, stands for composition, function composition. It takes three arguments. The first two are functions themselves, so function f and function g. The third is then an argument that is supplied to g, the result which is then supplied to f. So whenever I talk about the application of a function, what I then mean is that I supply arguments to a function with the intention to obtain the value that the function then gives me back. But if you have a function with a given arity, I need to give so many arguments. I need to supply so many arguments as there are arguments of the function. But it is also possible to do a partial application. And with a partial application, I give less arguments than the arity of a function. So I do not supply all the arguments, but I only supply some. And the result then does not denote the value of that function, but itself is now a function which takes the remaining arguments. So you can then, with partial application, supply the arguments one by one. So an example of a partial application is the following. Suppose you have plus, it's a function with arity 2. So let's say plus x, y, and it adds x and y. And the result is the result of the function plus x, y. So now you could say, well, what if we partially apply plus, so we supply it only a single argument and not both at the same time? So let's say plus 2. Well, then the result is not a value. The result is itself a function that takes the remaining arguments. And then what does it do with the remaining arguments? Well, in the case of plus, when you supply it a concrete value of 2, the result is a function that takes another argument and adds that 2 to it to obtain the final value. So in this way, if you write down plus where you first apply x, then, as you may know, application is left associating to left. So I first apply x to plus. And then the result is a function. And if I then apply y to the resulting function, then the value must be the same as if I supplied x and y in one go to plus. So from partial application, if you keep on supplying the arguments one by one, ultimately you will end up with an application of the function. So to show you a bit more concrete how this works, these partial applications, let's look at swap. So swap takes three arguments. It's a higher order function, so f itself is a function. And then two other arguments, x and y. And now we define swap to be, the value of swap with the three arguments is equal to the value we obtain by applying y and then x to f. So it is as if x and y are swapped, eh? Because we here apply y first to f. Okay, so then in this case, our swap function takes three arguments. But what if we now partially apply it? So what if we already supply one argument, but leave the other two, x and y, for later? So the result of the partial application where I've applied only f to swap must now be a function that takes the two remaining arguments. So how is that then defined? Well, swap where I apply first f and then I apply x and y is the same as f, but where I have applied y and then x. And here you can now see that swap f is f, but where the arguments are reversed. I can also apply f and x, say, to swap. Well, and in that case, I basically have only one remaining argument left. What I do then, okay, so I first give f and then x. The result is a function that takes one remaining argument, y. And if I supply that y, then indeed the result is the same as you would expect, the value. But you could also alternatively take this function, swap f, that still takes two arguments, and then supply that one with one argument, leaving also one remaining argument. And in that case, you have that if you partially apply to swap with one argument f, and then to the result you partially apply it with x, and then you apply it with y, that this must be the same as, well, partially applying swap with f, and then supplying x and y at the same time, and that we already know was equal to f, where we applied it with y and x at the same time. So this has given you an example of partial applications. Then the next concept in functional programming is function composition. Suppose you're given two functions, say f and g, then you could define the function composition as follows. So f circle g is itself a function that is defined by if you apply x to the composition of f g, then you first apply x to g, and then the result of that is then supplied to f. And then the result of that is then the result of our composition. Now, alternatively, you could have written it as defining the function composition as follows. It is a higher order function. So comp, standing for composition, is a higher order function that takes three arguments, f, g, and x. And now, whenever the three arguments are supplied, the x is first supplied to g, and the result is then supplied to f. So, as an example, let's look at the function composition of the successor function with itself. And so, here we have the successor function. If you remember, the successor function takes a natural number and then gives you back one higher. So, what do we obtain if we compose successor function with itself? Well, we could try to analyze that by thinking, what if we supply it a number? So suppose we now apply x to the resulting composition. Well, that's the same as first plugging in x into the successor. Well, that gives you x plus 1. And that result is then plugged again into the successor, which gives you x plus 1 plus 1. So x plus 2. So you can now also imagine that we combine different functions or functions with different arity. So what happens if we have, for instance, the plus function, which takes two numbers, and we compose that with the successor function, which takes only a single argument? Well, how does it work? Well, let's look at it. Suppose that in the resulting composition, we have applied x to the, we apply x to the composition of plus and successor. Well, that means then that we first plug in x into the successor function, and the result is then plugged into plus. But plus is a function which takes two arguments, But here we have only supplied a single argument. So this is a partial application of the plus function. So what can we then do? Well, suppose we plug in an additional. And so we apply the result with an additional value, say y. Then we now obtain, we plug in x to the successor. That result is then the first argument to plus. But y is applied after that. So what does this then mean? Well, x plus 1 plus y. Okay, so it's important to note that the order in which you do a function composition matters. So for instance, if we look here at plus composed with successor, that's a different function than the successor composed with plus. But that's an exercise and you could try to figure that out yourself why those are different functions. So function composition is also associative. Consider, for example, where we first compose g and h, and then the resulting function is composed with f. Or where we first compose g with f, and then the result is on the left of the composition with h, because the order is important. So as you can see here, the order of f, g, and h remains the same, but the way we have bracketed the composition is different. But now the nice thing is that function composition is associative, so that means it doesn't matter how you bracket it. To show that that is the case, well, take for instance an arbitrary value x. Now, if you supply the value x to the left-hand side, that's what we do here, then we expect it to have the same denotation or have the same value as the function composition on the right-hand side. But how do we do that? Okay, let's try to evaluate it. So we apply x to the composition, where we then must first apply x to the function on the right. But the function on the right itself is a composition. So what do we do there? Well, in this composition, we first apply x to h. Then the result of x applied to h is then applied to g, and that result is then applied to f. But hey, if we have this, then we could also see that this must be equal to the composition of f and g itself as a function being applied to hx. But that again is equal to the composition where we do f and g first on the left and then compose with h on the right. And why is this equal to what is on the top? Well, the definition of function composition takes x and it first applies it to h, and the result is then applied to the function on the left. Well, and that's stated here. And why is this equal to what is on top of it? Well, we take h, x, we first apply it to g, and then the result is applied to f, and that's stated what is here. And why is this then equal to what is on top of it? Well, here we apply x first to h, and then the result of that is applied to g. Well, that's precisely what this term here says. So that is establishing thus that f applied to g applied to h is the same as f applied to g, then applied to h. So the bracketing with function composition is not important. So now, after we have established that this holds for every x, we could say that then the functions must be equal. Because what we have here, function composition, it takes in two functions and it gives you back the function composition, which itself is a function. So these functions are equal whenever they are equal on every argument. And that notion is called function extensionality. Another example of a function would be the identity function. And the identity function takes one argument and its value is immediately that same argument. So the identity function ID, if you supply it one argument x, then the value is immediately that x. Now it turns out that for every function f, if you compose it with the identity function, then the function must be the same as that of f. Okay, so to know whether two functions are the same, we want to figure out whether the two functions have the same value for every argument. So take an arbitrary argument x. So then if we look at the function composition f composed with the identity function, if we take this function composition and apply x to it, well, that means that we first have to apply x to the id function, and that result is then supplied as an argument to f, and that is stated here. With that, we now know x applied to id is by definition equal to x. So there you then go. So f composed with id applied to x must be the same as f applied to x immediately. But since this holds for an arbitrary argument x, we can then again by function extensionality say that these functions must be the same. F composed with id is the same function as just f. And now you could imagine as an exercise to show that it is also the case that if you compose id with f, that is also the same as f. Okay, so that's the identity function and how the identity function works together with function composition. Another interesting concept is that of function iteration. And with function iteration, I mean that we keep on composing a particular function f that we're given with itself for a finite amount of time. So we could define function iteration, suppose that we want to iterate the function f n times, and we could define that using an analysis. We can recursively define it, as it is also called, by looking at n. What if n is zero? So then we look at f that is then zero times applied to itself. Well, that is just the identity function. We take that as a definition. And now for an arbitrary n that is non-zero, it must have the form n plus 1. Well, that we can then define, so by composing f with fn. So this means that if you concretely look at, for instance, the successor function, and then you iterate it zero times, well, then you get the identity. If you iterate it one times, well, then you see that you take the successor function and compose it with the identity function. But we already know that this is equal to the successor function itself. If you now iterate the successor function two times, it means that we compose the successor function two times with itself and then with the identity function. So this is the same as composing the successor function twice, etc. So as you can see in this definition, we don't talk at all about the argument. And we immediately say that this function on the left must be equal to the function on the right. And we don't talk about a function with a particular argument must be equal to some value. Now, we equate in our definition the functions directly. And as whenever you do that, then you could call it a point-free definition. Or some people call it a pointless definition. But that sounds a little bit weird. So, okay. Then, what shall we do with function iteration? Well, you can imagine that you keep on iterating, say. But what happens if you obtain as an outcome of the function the same thing as what you have supplied as an input to that function? Right? Whenever this occurs, we call it a fixed point of the function. So suppose you're given a function f. Now, the argument x is called a fixed point of that function f whenever it is true that the value of applying x to the function f is equal to x itself. And then x is called a fixed point of f. So, as I already hinted a little bit on, if you have this fixed point, then it doesn't matter how many times you apply f. The fixed point remains a fixed point, even if you keep on iterating the function f. So, and that is a claim that is now stated here. So given a function f, that has a fixed point x, that it is the case for an arbitrary n, that if you iterate f for n times, and then supply x, that the resulting value remains that x. Okay, but how does that then work? Well, there is a proof for that, and that is by induction on n, so that means that we have to consider two cases, the case where n is 0, and the induction step. And so the base case is 0, so we have to show that f0x must be equal to x, that is the original claim, but now for n we take 0. Well, this is obviously the case, because f0 is by our definition, by our point-free or pointless definition, it must be equal to the identity function. But then we now must show that the identity function applied to x is equal to x. Hey, but that is the case. Eh? That is by definition of the identity function the case. Okay, so the base case is then established. Then we can show the step case. So in the step case, we assume what we want to prove, and then prove that it also holds whenever we go to the next number. So we assume for an arbitrary n that it is already the case fnx is equal to x. That's what we assume. And now we want to show that if we then iterate f one more time, so fn plus 1 apply to x, then still the result is equal to x. Okay, so if we do that, then we can argue about it as follows. So by definition of function iteration, fn plus 1 must be equal, in the point 3 definition, to f composed with fn. But then by the definition of function composition, that's this one here, by definition of the function composition, we know that we first apply x to fn, and then the result is applied to f, so that is what is stated here. So here x is first applied to fn, then we obtain this, and then that result is applied to f. Okay, but then what do then? Hey, we already have an assumption. Fn applied to x must be equal to x. So we here have fn applied to x. So that one we could replace by, we know it's equal, so we equals can be replaced by each other. Eh? So if we know it's equal, so whenever we see this, we can replace it by x. That's what we do. So then we know, oh, well, then it's equal to f of x. Eh? But then we know also we're given a function f for which x is a fixed point of f. Eh? So then we know fx must be equal to x. And that's by definition that x is a fixed point of f, because then we know fx is equal to x. So this fx must be equal to x, because x is a fixed point of f. Okay, so that's the proof why as soon as you have reached the fixed point, keeping on iterating the function does not move you. Eh? You keep on the fixed point. That's maybe even why it's called a fixed point. Okay, let's continue. Given a function f, you can ask yourself now, is it always the case that for this arbitrary function f, it must have a fixed point? Well, you could pause the video and try to figure it out for yourself, but here comes the answer. So consider the following example. Let f be defined by fx is equal to x plus 1. So f is, let's take the successor function. Well, if then f has a fixed point, say y, well then y, if it is a fixed point, must be the case that f of y applied to f must be equal to y itself. But then by definition of our function f, it is the case that fy must be equal to y plus 1. But it is not the case that y plus 1 is equal to y. So y cannot be a fixed point. And since this is for an arbitrary fixed point, no such fixed point can exist. So the answer to the question, does f always have a fixed point, is no, because we have reached the contradiction. If all functions f have a fixed point, then from that we can find this counterexample, which leads to a contradiction. So no, not all functions have a fixed point. There exist functions without a fixed point, such as the one defined here, the successor function. Next question. Given a function f that has a fixed point, so we know f has a fixed point x, is it now the case that x is the only fixed point? So is this fixed point unique? So if you want to figure it out yourself, you can pause the video. But the answer comes now. Okay, so again, consider an example f. So as a definition for this example f, take the fx to be defined to have the value 1 whenever x is smaller than 2, but it has the value 3 whenever x is bigger than or equal to 2. Okay, then try to evaluate the function f with the argument 1. Well, so we plug in 1 here. Well, what is then the result? If the argument is 1, 1 is smaller than 2, so then the resulting value of the function must be 1. Eh? So f1 is 1. So since the argument and the value of the function on that argument is the same, 1 is a fixed point of f. But what if we supply 3 as an argument? Well, we plug in 3. 3 obviously is bigger than or equal to 2 because it's bigger than 2. So then the resulting value of f on the argument 3 is itself 3. So as you can see, the argument 3 has as a value when applied to function f also the value 3. So 3 is also a fixed point. Hey, but now f has a fixed point. So 1. Is 1 the only fixed point? No, because 3 is also a fixed point. So the answer to our question is no. The fixed point is not unique. Not always unique. Eh? You could imagine that there are functions with a unique fixed point. But it is not always the case that if there is a fixed point, that then that fixed point is unique. Okay. So now consider the following higher order function. Eh? So it's a function that takes as an argument a function. So suppose that we have a function f with a fixed point and we don't know what is the fixed point, but let's say that we know some fixed point exists. And it doesn't have to be a unique fixed point. Eh? It could be an arbitrary fixed point of f. But we know that there is some fixed point. Well, then we could ask ourselves, could we now give a name to that fixed point? Well, to do that, we could define a higher order function. Let's call that higher order function fix. And fix takes in as an argument a function f, but we assume that f has a fixed point. So then whenever you supply f to fix, and f itself has a fixed point, then what we say is that fix of f is the fixed point of f. So that means that fix applied, f applied to the higher order function fix, must itself be a fixed point of f. So what does that then mean? Well, if we apply f to that fixed point, well, by definition of fixed point, then the fixed point of f, so that's this one, that this value must be a fixed point of f. And well, that's the case here. Eh? Because if we supply it as an argument, then the result of the function is the same as the argument. Okay, so that's how we can then define this higher order function. So fix takes in a function and it gives back the fixed point or a fixed point of that function. But we have assumed, of course, that f supplied has a fixed point. If f now does not have a fixed point, we could say that fix of f is just an arbitrary value. Eh? So we don't care about that case. You could argue, is it then a definition? Okay, good point. We could take a fixed value, say 0. If f doesn't have a fixed point, then fix of f is 0. And then it's a definition of this higher order function. Okay, fix takes as an input, it has a single argument, a function itself, and we assume that that function has a fixed point. If it doesn't, then let's fix that to 0. And otherwise, if it has a fixed point, then it produces precisely a value that is a fixed point of the input function. Okay, so this is kind of a tricky definition. But it's a very important definition, because then now it allows me to introduce you to a specific term in the lambda calculus. And that term in the lambda calculus implements this fixed point operator. And why is that important? I can maybe say something a little bit about that. it allows you to express recursive functions. Okay, but that's maybe also for during the classroom discussion. So how would it then look like? Well, the lambda expression that implements the fixed point is the following. It's called the Y combinator. And so the Y combinator is a specific lambda expression. And in this case, we here have an abstraction operator. We abstract F. And then the body of the abstraction is this application, where we apply the right-hand abstraction to the left-hand abstraction. And then under the A, you can see these are the same terms. Interesting. And then in this term, you see it's a lambda abstraction itself, in which the variable X is applied to itself, and then that result is then applied to F being on the outer. So you could now already try to understand how would you parse this lambda expression, eh? I mean, can you imagine the abstract syntax tree corresponding to this expression? Yeah, that's important to realize how to do that. So now I assume that you can do that now. I want to now show how this lambda expression then implements this fixed point, this fixed point higher order function. Well, for that, we could take an arbitrary lambda expression m, and let's assume that it doesn't have any free occurrences of x, because x here occurs bound. And now we apply m to the lambda expression y. And now, if you may remember from the previous video, we can reduce that lambda expression into by then, what do? We see on the left of an application, we have an abstraction. And on the right, we have an arbitrary term. And what we can then do, we can simplify the expression by removing the abstraction and take this f variable that is then bound here and here. And we replace that by the argument m in this case. So then what we obtain in one beta reduction step is where here we have the lambda f that occurs here and here. We have replaced the lambda f, and we just look at the body of the abstraction where we have replaced f by the argument m. So then we obtain this lambda term. Again, now we see an application on the outer level, and on the left-hand side there is an abstraction term, so lambda x m with x applied to x as an argument. Hey, and that we can also beta reduce, so then that results into the following term. Here we have the body mxx. So that's the body, the m here. But then what is x? Well, x is then replaced by the right side of the application. So this one is plugged in the place of x that is bound here and here. So that means that this one is then replaced here and this one is replaced over here. And then we obtain the following lambda expression. Okay. But then you could, if you now reverse the world, so if we work now instead of forward, if we would have worked backward, hey, there's something interesting going on. Suppose we have m and we apply it to the result of applying m to this y expression. Well, what do we do if we apply m to y? We have already seen that here. Then we see that we have two of those lambda x, m, x, x expressions, but those are the same here. As you can see, this expression here is identical to the expression here. So that is then we could have obtained that as if we stated here that we have the y expression applied to m itself. Okay, that's interesting. So how does this then implement our fix higher order function? Well, to explain that, I maybe introduce you first quite essential concepts in functional programming, which is namely the concepts of function equality or equivalence. So suppose you're given two functions f and g. You could say, this is also already what we have seen before, function extensionality. You could say that f and g are equal to each other whenever it's the case that f and g are equal for all the possible values that you could supply as an argument to these functions. So to know that two functions are equal, you have to check or prove to yourself that if you supply it any possible value as an argument to f, then the value must be the same as if you would have supplied that as an argument to g. And if that is the case, then you could call f and g to be extensionally equal. But there are different notions of equality whenever we consider equality in the lambda calculus, because equality of lambda expressions, they're syntactical objects. Functions, they are mathematical objects. So this is an equality, mathematically speaking, but we already know what equality is of expressions. Let's just look at the expression and do they have the same symbols? Expressions are the result of some parse on a string of symbols. So what is the equality of two expressions? They have the identical sequence of symbols. Right? And that equality we call definitional equality. So two expressions are equal whenever they have the same string of symbols. But how can we now mean that, hey, we have two different expressions, but we want them to, lambda expressions in this case, we want to express that they're in some way equal, but they're not equal in the sense of syntactic equality. No, what we want to say is they're equal, they mean the same thing. Well, and to do that, you could define intentional equality, and this is also called, in some other context, equivalence, equivalence, meaning they have the same value. Well, and that is then, you can understand, in the lambda calculus, two lambda expressions are equivalent whenever they reduce to a common expression. So whenever you start with an m and an n, and it is the case that if you keep on you have a reduction sequence. This is just a nice way, very short way of saying there exists a reduction sequence that starts in M and ends in O. And there exists also a reduction sequence that starts in N and it ends in O. If both are the case, well, then we could say that M and N are equivalent in the lambda calculus. But there could be, of course, of different syntactical ways of building them. Syntactically speaking, M and N could be different, while their meaning, their value is still the same. Okay, so if we want to show that we have implemented this fixed higher order function in the lambda calculus, what do we want to show then? Well, what we want to show is that our expression y is an implementation of a fixed point combinator, because for this arbitrary expression m that we supply as an argument to y, we can see the same as the definition of fix. But now instead of having equality, we have equivalence. So if you go back to fix, you see, hey, the fixed point of f is precisely equal, so it is the same value. So the value of the function fix applied to f is the same as f of fix of f. So that is also what we now have obtained here. That if we apply m to the expression y that is defined here, then the result is equivalent with m, but then m, where we apply m to y, and that result we apply to m. And this is the same as this definition of our higher order function. So that we could then say, this is a implementation of that higher order function. Okay, but if that is then the case, then every arbitrary lambda expression, where we don't have, by the way, a free occurrence of x, but it doesn't really matter so much. Every arbitrary lambda expression then has a fixed point. Why? Well, because the fixed point operator, the y operator, this term here, gives you that fixed point. But that's weird, because mathematical functions don't necessarily have a fixed point. But every lambda expression does have a fixed point. Well, then that must mean that they're different. But we already knew that they were different, because, for instance, there are functions for which there doesn't exist an implementation in the lambda calculus, the uncomputable functions. So, okay. This, I just wanted to show you the existence of this Y combinator. If you don't fully understand how it works, don't panic. I mean, that's never a good idea. But this just, I try to confer you, hey, there's this interesting notion of a Y combinator. And later in the course, whenever we talk about functions again, I can show you how to use the Y combinator to implement a recursive function. Before I end this video, I still want to say a little bit about referential transparency. And referential transparency is an important concept in functional programming languages. And now I demonstrated using the lambda calculus, but it applies to most functional programming languages, or functional programming languages, most of them have the property of referential transparency. So if you are given two expressions, M and N, then you call referential transparency intuitively that if M and N are equivalent, yeah. So what does that mean again? Oh yeah, that was that they reduce to a common expression. Then if M and N are equivalent, then for arbitrary occurrence of M, you may replace it by N. So this referential transparency you could understand as, okay, as soon as I know that I have some expression, and say that expression reduces to a particular value, then anywhere where I see that expression, I can replace that expression by its value. Yeah? That's the idea of referential transparency. So the expression cannot depend on its evaluation on the context, so to say. If I know that a particular expression is equivalent to a value, then I can replace it anywhere by that value. Yeah, but this is the notion of referential transparency. Formally, you could understand it as soon as you know that M and N are equivalent, then in any other sort of expression O where we see an occurrence, one or multiple occurrences of M, we could replace those occurrences, the ones that we want to actually replace by N. It's as if we have some expression O with a free occurrence X. And then if we then have that M and N are equivalent, then replacing X by M in our O would be the same, also equivalent, as if we have substituted this X for N. And so this referential transparency, it's sometimes also called the substitution property. It allows you to substitute one expression for another expression whenever that expression has the same value. Now, that is the end of this video. Thank you for watching, and I hope to see you soon again.